Yeah, so you can start.
Okay. Jai Bhim, everyone. Thank you all for joining 43rd episode of Ambedkar Lecture Series organized by Boston Study Group, a not-for-profit Ambedkarite organization in USA, working in New England states of America. Boston Study Group founded 5 years back to spread awareness about the caste-based discrimination in India, its impact on lives of millions of people, and a dehumanizing life so-called untouchables or Dalits have to endure. We do this by organizing studies of Babasaheb's literature, sponsoring the conferences, awareness study sessions in universities on these issues, providing financial supports to deserving students from India to attend such conferences, providing humanitarian help in situations like pandemic situations we are going through now. The Constitution of India, or Bharatiya Samvidhan, is the longest written constitution of any country on earth and supreme law of India. It lays down the framework demanding fundamental political code, structure, procedures, powers, and duties of government institution, and sets out fundamental rights, directive principles, and duties of citizens. When concept of writing a constitution was taking shape, many stalwarts in Indian politics at that time was proposing for government with regional autonomy, whereas Babasaheb is the one who was strongly a proponent of the governing system with strong federal government. That's why in 17 years of its adaptation, we find a cohesive country with all states living in peace with each other. Whereas when we look at the history of oldest democracy in the world, USA, we know they had gone through the World Civil War within first 70 years of implementation of their constitution, where 620,000 Americans lost their life. If you are watching what is going on in US election this year, so many flaws in this system were resurfaced, which could have taken this country from democracy to authoritarian in just one election. When we see Indian constitution, it is still standing tall, and all Indians owe Dr. Ambedkar a gratitude for providing this marvelous constitution. But as Babasaheb says, however good a constitution may be, if those who are implementing it are not good, it will prove to be bad. However bad a constitution may be, if those implementing it are good, it will prove to be good. So all Indians, especially Ambedkarites, need to be vigilant on who we choose to implement the constitution and need to know what is Indian constitution. So we have among us Professor Devidas Godeswar to enlighten us on constitution of India, and especially Dr. Ambedkar's socio-economic, political, and philosophical embodied in constitution of India. He will also speak about how is the current policies and process are trying to destroy Indian constitution. Professor Godeswar taught in many colleges, including Dr. Ambedkar College and PWS College in Nagpur. He translated many of Dr. Babasaheb Ambedkar's books from English to Marathi, like What Congress and Gandhi Have Done to Untouchables, Buddha and His Dhamma, Dr. Ambedkar at the Roundtable Conferences. He wrote 2 books in Marathi on administration of community-based organization and Bharat Rashtra versus Hindu Rashtra. He is currently editor-in-chief of Marathi magazine Vandana Sangha Dhamma Ghosh. With this brief introduction, I invite Professor Godeswar to start his speech.
Sadhuvad, Mangal Kamna, and Sapre Jai Bhim. Thanks to Boston Study Group for inviting me to deliver this particular talk and providing me an opportunity to participate in this dialogue, international dialogue. Recently, in this month, on 6th December, we observed 64th Mahaparinirvan Day of Dr. B.R. Ambedkar. Still, we are in that particular mood. Therefore, I dedicate this particular lecture or this particular talk to the memory of Dr. B.R. Ambedkar. I belong to Vandana Sangha Dikshabhumi Nagpur, a small organization dedicated, committed, and devoted to Lord Buddha, the Enlightened One, his Dhamma and philosophy, and Honorable Dr. B.R. Ambedkar and his socio-economic political philosophy. Vandana Sangha also works on the issues related to education, reservation, and atrocities. As in the introduction, it is being said, Vandana Sangha publishes a magazine, monthly magazine in Marathi called Dhamma Ghosh. Regularly, we are publishing it since 2007. And recently, due to this corona pandemic, the publication is suspended since April 2020. And when the pandemic will be over, the publication will be resumed. Therefore, on behalf of Vandana Sangha Diksha Bhumi Nagpur, and on my behalf, I pay homage to the memory of Dr. Ambedkar and the tributes to him also. We, the masses in India, revere Dr. Ambedkar as the liberator of humankind. We, the people who are oppressed, suppressed, exploited, excluded, and neglected people of this country, revere Dr. Ambedkar as our liberator. This is not a hero worship at all. We don't believe in hero worship because Dr. Ambedkar himself, while delivering a speech, last speech in Constituent Assembly on 25th November 1949, categorically warned Indians that hero worship in politics is dangerous to democracy, is an invitation for dictatorship, and due to this particular hero worship, the democracy will be destroyed and the dictatorship will be established. It will lead to chaos. It will lead to calamity. It will lead to catastrophe. Therefore, we don't believe in this hero worship. When I say that Dr. Ambedkar is liberator of humankind, I mean to say that we believe in Dr. Ambedkar's socio-economic political philosophy, which is a liberating philosophy for us. In three words, I would like to say that the socio-economic political philosophy of Dr. Ambedkar is secular, liberal, democratic philosophy. The subject of this talk is Ambedkar and Constitution, or Ambedkar and Constitution of India. If someone wants to understand Dr. Ambedkar as well as the Constitution of India, one has to very categorically declare oneself that he is Indian first. We the Indians having multiple identities. I am Indian, I am Buddhist. If I belong to Hindu religion, then I am Indian, then I am Hindu, and then I have a caste identity also. So therefore in India, we have an identity as an Indian, we have an identity of the religion, we have an identity of the caste. In India, generally, we find that the people prefer their religious and caste identities. These identities cloud our vision. These identities make us biased. Suppose I am Hindu and that is my first identity, then when I see the Constitution, I say that it is written by an untouchable, by Ashok Treaty. So it is the biased approach towards the Dr. Ambedkar and towards the Constitution of India. Even Buddhists are biased because they don't tolerate any criticism either of Dr. Ambedkar or of the Constitution. So if you want to understand Dr. Ambedkar and the Constitution drafted by him, we have to be very categorical to say that I am Indian first. Dr. Ambedkar in 1929 said that he is Indian first and Indian last. I can't bear. To say that I am Indian first and Indian last because I can't discard my religious identity also. The first, I am Indian first means I am loyal to the Constitution. I am dedicated to the Constitution. I am committed to the Constitution. I will follow, I am following the Constitution in my day-to-day life, and I am ready, I am willing to sacrifice anything and everything for the protection of the Constitution. Constitution is my first religion also. And if that dedication is there, if that commitment is there, then it becomes easy for me to understand the Constitution as well as to understand the Dr. Ambedkar, the father of Constitution of India. In simple words, Constitution means principles or precedents for governing the state. Constitution provides principles or precedents for governing the states. Precedent, the word is here, for those countries it is applicable where there is no written constitution. In England, there is no written constitution. Therefore, England follows the precedents established by the Parliament of England. In America, there is a written constitution. In India, there is a written constitution. And our constitution gives us the principles for governing the state. Sometimes this is called, constitution is called the basic fundamental law of the country, law of the land also. Basic fundamental law means all the laws which are required, which are enacted for governing the state and the people are originated from the constitution. They are within the frame of the constitution and they are consistent with the constitution. If any law is inconsistent or any law is not within the frame of the constitution, then the proper authorities declare that law as void. No doubt, Indian constitution gives us the principles for governing the state. Indian constitution is also a basic fundamental law, but Indian constitution is beyond that. While drafting the constitution, while making the constitution, the Constituent Assembly was also thinking of providing vision for reconstruction of Indian society based on liberal democratic principles, based on secular liberal democratic values. And therefore, simultaneously, not only they are drafting the principles for governing the states, they were also preparing the vision of future society. And categorically, the preamble of the Constitution of India provides the vision of future society also. And I will explain it later on, what is the preamble of the Constitution. But for me, Constitution is a philosophy also. Constitution is a philosophy also. Therefore, our Constitution is contains the principles for governing the state. It is a basic fundamental law. It is a vision document and it is a philosophy. I say that the Constitution of India is an embodiment of political, economic and social philosophy of Dr. Ambedkar. Constitution enshrines the political, economic and social philosophy of Dr. Ambedkar, which are, in few words, it is secular, democratic, liberal philosophy of Dr. Ambedkar. Why I say like this? Because I will give evidences for this also. In 1946, Dr. Ambedkar drafted one document called States and Minorities. The document, why Dr. Ambedkar drafted this particular document? Because in 1946, British Parliament announced that they will leave India and India will achieve its independence. As all the independent countries are having their own constitutions framed by their own people, British Parliament also announced that they will constitute a constituent assembly which will frame the Constitution of India, which will just make the Constitution of India. And this Constitution Assembly will be a representative body of the Indian people. And for constituting the Constituent Assembly, British Parliament also announced a plan, and according to that particular plan, the representatives on the Constituent Assembly were supposed to be elected by the provincial assemblies, which were the part of the provinces, which are the part of the British India. Some representatives were to be nominated by the Indian states also. So it was a conglomerate of the party of the representatives from the British India as well as from the Indian states. Then, when the elections for Constituent Assembly were declared, Dr. Ambedkar wanted to go in the Constituent Assembly as a representative of his people. But accidentally, or it was a decided strategy of Congress Party that they would see that Dr. Ambedkar will not get elected from the Mumbai Legislative Council on the Constituent Assembly. And the result was not a single member of All India Scheduled Caste Federation at that time, this was the political party of Dr. Ambedkar, got elected on Mumbai Legislative Council. Therefore, there was no member to nominate Dr. Ambedkar as a candidate for the election of the Constituent Assembly. And Dr. Ambedkar found that. Dr. Ambedkar realized that there are no chances of getting elected on the Constituent Assembly from Mumbai Legislative Council. Therefore, he drafted this particular document to be used there for lobbying and advocacy with the members of the Constituent Assembly so that the rights and the privileges of the scheduled caste are protected in the Constituent Assembly. The document was published in the March 1947. This document is a miniature. It was drafted, and the major part of that particular document is incorporated in the present Constitution of India. Another evidence is 1956, the year is most important in the life of Dr. Ambedkar, in the life of Ambedkar people, and in the life of India also. On 14th October 1956, Dr. Ambedkar embraced Buddhism along with more than 0.5 million people of his followers. And therefore, Dr. Ambedkar is recognized all over the world as the Dhamma Chakra Pravartak. In the 1956, he also declared that All India Scheduled Caste Federation will be dissolved and a new political party called Republican Party of India will be formed. And he drafted the constitution of that political party named Republican Party of India. And in that particular document, in that constitution of Republican Party of India, he categorically said that the aims and objectives of Republican Party of India will be aims and objectives of the preamble of the Constitution of India. And the party will work for reconstruction of the Indian society based on the values enshrined in the preamble of the Constitution of India. I think this is enough to establish that the Constitution is an embodiment of the secular, liberal, democratic philosophy of the Constitution. This particular philosophy is embodied in three parts of the Constitution of India: the preamble, the fundamental rights, and the directive principles of state policy. About the preamble now. About the preamble, in one of the judgment of 2017, which was related to the right to privacy. In that judgment, the 9-judge constitution bench categorically say that the preamble of the constitution is the soul of the constitution, is the spirit of the constitution. Beyond that, the Supreme Court says that Each and every word incorporated in the preamble of the Constitution of India is very important word. It carries a specific meaning. Again, Supreme Court says, as it says, that the sequence in which the words in the preamble are arranged is also a very important sequence. Neither Supreme Court nor Parliament can dare to change a single word from the preamble of the Constitution or to alter the sequence. This is the importance and relevance of preamble.
Vamanji, can you? I think there is an issue with the bandwidth. I think in that case you can stop the video and just go with the audio in if you want.
No, no problem. Any problem there?
Yeah, in between the your audio and video is freezing, so that's why I think there is maybe the issue with the bandwidth. So if we can just keep the audio on and switch off the video, that will help.
Okay, if that is all right to you, then I will go for that.
Yeah, go ahead, please. Go ahead. We but in between it just freezes. So let's see. Go ahead, please, sir.
The word India, which appears in the preamble of the Constitution of India.
Sir, you can continue on audio.
Okay.
Yeah. Continue with the audio. So only the.
Is it all right? I am audible.
Yeah. Audio is okay.
So I said, that I'm on with the words in the people of India. Declaration that India is a nation. Dr. Ambedkar in the Constituent Assembly, Dr. Ambedkar in his book, Pakistan or Partition of India, categorically said that before this, there was a nation like India on this particular side. India was not a nation at all. India had multinational identities, or India had multinational entities, but not a single nation as an Indian nation. So Constitution declares India as a nation first. Constitution provides the identity, the preamble provides the identity that we are Indian national. We are Indian nationals. So these two things are related with India, and therefore we call ourselves we the people of India. We are the Indian nationals. India is a nation. Union by Constitution of India. Then the word people. The word people is the most important people. Here, people means people have a seven subjects ruled by British. In between 15th August 1947 and 26th January 1950, we were again the subjects ruled by the natives. But on 25th January 1950, the constitution was promulgated and we become people. People here means we are ruled by ourselves. We are neither ruled by the foreigners nor ruled by the native people. We are ruled by people. We are ruled by ourselves, number one. Number two, people here means all inclusiveness is here. Everybody is included in this concept of people. Third thing is people means all are equal. People means all are equal. Fourth thing is people. This term is a secular term. This term is a secular. I can say that I am Buddhist people. Someone can say that he is a Hindu people like this. So this is a secular term. People are sovereign. It is people are all inclusive. People are secular. People are all equal. This is the meaning. Now I will little bit elaborate the word sovereignty of the people. Sovereignty of the people in the base, that people are a source of power and authority. Our democracy is a parliamentary democracy, but it is also called as a representative democracy because there is no direct democracy in India because all the people can't participate in making laws. Therefore, it is called a parliamentary democracy. In parliamentary democracy, where people are sovereign, people have a right and authority to elect their representatives. After electing their representatives, people delegate some of their powers and authorities to the elected representatives and ask them to function on behalf of the people. If the representatives did not function properly, then people to withdraw their representation, call them.
Continue, please.
Again, in the preamble says like this. Having solemnly resolved to constitute India into a sovereign democratic republic. The words democratic republic are also used in the preamble of the Constitution of India. The democracy and republic were very dear and near to Dr. B.R. Ambedkar. Democracy is a cornerstone of ask for voting rights for the untouchables. That is a part of democracy he was advocating for. Then in 1928, Simon Commission also has given the representation asking for voting rights, not only for scheduled castes, not only for race, but he asked voting rights for women, tribals, and criminal tribes also. People were shocked. People said that how these illiterate people will be able to use their voting right judiciously, rationally. But Dr. Ambedkar said, if the Indians demand dominion status, then they have to have a faith in the people also. Roundtable Conference categorically said to the Britishers that please leave our country and give us a government of the people, by the people, and for the people. It is again a demand for independence of India, demand for democracy, and demand for political participation, political power sharing by the depressed classes. Then that democracy has arrived in our constitution also. Dr. Ambedkar on and often quoted the definition of Abraham Lincoln of democracy, government of the people, by the people, and for the people. But he was not satisfied with this particular definition, because this definition only says that democracy is a system of government, or democracy is a system of governance only. For Dr. Ambedkar, democracy was beyond that. And therefore, he defined democracy in his own way. Dr. Ambedkar says, my definition of democracy is different one. I define democracy differently and in a more concrete way. He said that democracy means system of government through which social, economic, political changes in the life of people are brought about without bloodshed. So, democracy is a system which can revolutionize the social, economic, political lives of people with people's participation. If changes are brought about with people's participation, then those changes will be everlasting. So he did not have any faith in the bloody revolution, and therefore he was asking for democracy. And when he got opportunity to draft the Constitution of India, he incorporated this word democratic republic in the preamble of the Constitution, and the entire Constitution is being drafted for the establishment and successful implementation of democracy on the Indian soil. Then again, the preamble says justice, social, economic, and political. Social justice, social equality. Economic justice, each individual in the Indian continent should have a right to live a life with dignity. That is economic justice. Political justice means equal opportunities for political participation, equal opportunities for political power sharing. Then, liberty of thought. Liberty of thought, expression, belief, faith, and worship. These are individual freedoms. And then equality of status and opportunity. Dr. Ambedkar's whole struggle was for inculcating or establishing the principle of equality in Indian society. And then again, Dr. Ambedkar talks in the preamble about dignity of the individual and unity and integrity of the nation. Therefore, preamble says justice, liberty, equality, fraternity, dignity of the individual, and unity and integrity of the nation. This is the crux of the philosophy of Dr. Ambedkar also. Throughout his political career, Dr. Ambedkar talked about justice, Dr. Ambedkar talked about liberty, Dr. Ambedkar talked about equality, fraternity, and dignity of the individual also, and unity and integrity of the nation. Once while talking on the integrity and unity of India, Mr. L.K. Advani said that though having much more disintegrating forces in the Indian society, India still remains united and integrated because of the constitution drafted by Dr. B.R. Ambedkar. Dr. Ambedkar took a step, there were a lot of challenges, but while drafting the constitution, he took utmost care so that the integrity and unity of India will remain intact. India is a nation declared by the constitution, but India is becoming, in the process of becoming a nation also, because the Indian society is to be reconstructed, is to be rebuilt on the principles enshrined in the preamble of India. And unless and until it is reconstructed or rebuilt on those principles, India will remain in the process of making a nation itself. It was a commitment of the Indian people to constitute India into a democratic republic, to constitute India, rebuild India on the principles or on the values enshrined in the preamble of the Constitution. It was a commitment of that particular generation, it was a commitment of the present generation, and it will remain a commitment of the future generation also, as long as India is not reconstructed based on the principles of these principles or values which are enshrined in the Constitution. Second part of philosophy is the fundamental rights. Fundamental rights are called natural rights or birth rights also. Generally, it is said that they are originated from the French Revolution of 1789. French Revolution gave democracy to the world, it is said like that, but Dr. Ambedkar did not agree with this. Dr. Ambedkar said that I did not borrow democracy from the French Revolution, I took this democracy from the Buddhist Sangha. Buddhist Sangha where nothing else but the parliamentary democratic system was followed for the regulation of Buddhist Sangha. I took democracy from the Buddhist Sangha. So, French Revolution, then this fundamental right constitution in on 25th December 1957, addressing the conference at Mahad, Dr. Ambedkar said that and quoted the fundamental rights derived from the French Revolution and compared that particular conference with the French Revolution and said that this conference is being organized to establish the principle of equality in the society. So these fundamental rights, as I said, that fundamental rights are natural rights, fundamental rights are birth rights, and therefore Supreme Court, while interpreting the Constitution, says that Constitution did not give us the fundamental rights. Neither the state gives us the fundamental right. Neither Constitution nor state gives anybody the fundamental right. Then what Constitution does? Constitution recognizes the fundamental rights, and Constitution guarantees their protection from the violation of state, from the invasion of state. This is the role of the Constitution as a protector, as a guarantor of fundamental rights, because they are birth rights. In fundamental rights, there are three subheadings. There are three subtitles. First is right to equality. Article 14 to 18, they prescribe right to equality. Article 14 says equality before law. Article 15 says there will be no discrimination on the basis of religion, race, caste, or sex, or place of origin. No discrimination at all. Article 16 says there will be equal opportunities in the appointment or in the recruitment of government services, public services. Then Article 17 says untouchability is abolished. So these are the articles provide the principle of equality, right to equality to the Indian citizens. But it also incorporates the provisions for social justice also. 15(4). The reservation in education to scheduled caste, scheduled tribes, and OBCs also. 16(4) provides a provision or gives reservation in government services to scheduled caste, scheduled tribes, and OBCs also. So these provisions are called provisions for social justice. So this chapter, or this part of right to equality of the fundamental rights, contains two principles. One is equality, second is social justice. And on 30th November 1948, while deliberating on Article 10 from the draft constitution. And now in this constitution, this article is Article 16. While talking on this, while speaking on this particular article, and while answering the queries and questions raised by the members of the Constituent Assembly, Dr. Ambedkar said that there must be a balance between the principle of equality and principle of social justice. Must be a balance. Otherwise, if more social justice, equality will be destroyed. If more equality, there will be no social justice. And therefore, Dr. Ambedkar said that reservation always should be or must be in minority. 38 November 1948, reservation should always be in minority while discussing Article 16. It is not a brainchild. The decision is not a brainchild of Supreme Court declared in the case of Indira Sahani case. While interpreting the Constitution, Supreme Court refers the Constituent Assembly debates and try to find out that whether something is mentioned in the debates. And this particular limitation on the reservation, not more than 50%, less than 50% in minority is brought down or is taken by the Supreme Court, and Supreme Court ruled that reservation will always be in minority. Another category is right to freedom. Here, freedom of thought, freedom of expression, other freedoms have been granted. And the most important article is Article 21, which says that right to life and personal liberty. I will say that this right to life means right to live. Supreme Court, while interpreting this particular article, said that right to live means right to live with dignity. Human beings should live like a human being, not a being, not only as a being. And therefore, this right to live means right to live with dignity. And therefore, it includes right to livelihood, right to education, and right to health services. They are the part of the fundamental right. They are the part of Article 21. We, the people of India, don't know this, don't understand this, and therefore we are not demanding these rights from the state, though they are being declared as fundamental rights by the Supreme Court. And then Article 25, most important article. Article 25 guarantees freedom of religion. The special characteristic, distinct characteristic of Indian constitution is Indian constitution is a secular constitution. At the same time, it guarantees freedom of religion also. Constitution is secular, state is secular, and all the institutions which are originated from the constitution are secular institutions. The Rashtrapati or the President of India is an institution. The Parliament of India, the legislatures of the states, judiciary and executive and other institutions originated from the constitution are secular institutions, and they must function as secular institutions. Secularism here means there is no religion of the state. State will have no religion. Another thing is state will not promote any religion or will not suppress any religion also. This is expected. But at present, the head of our government, the Prime Minister of India, have very less regard, doesn't regard this principle of secularism as a constitutional, very valid principle at all. Therefore, he hosts the foundation stone laying ceremony of Ram Mandir. It is really, in real sense, it is a destruction of the principle of secularism in Indian society. Dr. Ambedkar could see that this Article 25 guarantees the freedom of religion to all, but While framing the constitution, there was a challenge before the constitution maker. Challenge was after partition of India, Pakistan, the nation, Pakistan nation was created on the basis of the religion. And here in India, the Hindutva forces demanded that as Pakistan has become a separate nation, the rest of the India should be declared as a Hindu nation. Dr. Ambedkar was deadly against it. And therefore, Dr. Ambedkar said that India will be a nation having secular democratic republic. Being secular democratic republic. And therefore, to protect the minority religions, this clause of 25 is being incorporated. The Article 25 gives freedom of religion, means freedom to practice one's religion, freedom to propagate, and freedom to convert also. So this is Article 25. When it was asked to Dr. Ambedkar, which article is more important to you in the Constitution? Dr. Ambedkar said, Article 32 is most important article for me because Article 32 provides the remedies. The fundamental rights are rights against the state. State encroaches on fundamental rights. State violates fundamental rights. And to guarantee the protection from the violation of state or encroachment of state, this Article 32 provides remedies. And therefore, Article 22 guarantees a right to the citizens of India that if their fundamental rights are violated, they can appeal to Supreme Court and High Courts, and they can get the redressal from the courts. And therefore, Article 32 for Dr. Ambedkar is was most important article of the constitution and fundamental right. Dr. Ambedkar said that without remedy, fundamental rights will have no meaning at all. And then these are the fundamental rights. And then the directive principles of state policy. Fundamental rights are called justiciable rights. If they are denied, the citizens can go to the court. Directive principles also contain certain rights, but they are not justiciable rights. Therefore, the Dr. Ambedkar was questioned in the Constituent Assembly why he is incorporating these directive principles of state policy in the Constitution. Directive principles that Dr. Ambedkar said, they are the guidelines for the state. They are the guidelines for the government to formulate their policies in favor of the people. At that time, India was declared as a welfare state, and the maxim was maximum good of maximum number. Directive principles are related to economic justice also. Directive principles are for economic justice, and Dr. Ambedkar said, though they are not justiciable, but the representatives of the people will have to go to the people for getting elected or re-elected. And then at that time, people will ask their representatives, what did they did about the directive principles? If they had not done anything about the directive principles, the people will reject them as their representatives. And therefore, in the court of people, these rights will be justified and demanded from the representatives of the people. These are the basic tenets. These are the basic features of the liberal, secular, democratic philosophy of Dr. B.R. Ambedkar enshrined in the Constitution of India. I will now refer few more things. One thing is Article 368, which authorizes Parliament to amend the Constitution. Dr. Ambedkar said during the making of the Constitution and later on also that the words contained in the Constitution are not final words. They are subject to amendments. the constitution is subject to amendment and modification. Because if constitution wants to be an organic document, if constitution wants to be a long living document, then constitution must have a flexibility to change according to the changing situations, according to the needs of the future generation. And therefore, provision of amending the constitution is made in the constitution itself by Dr. Ambedkar. Till today, as per my information, 103 amendments are being made in the constitution of India. At the same time, Supreme Court, under Article 147, has given an authority to interpret the Constitution of India. And while interpreting, the Constitution of India, Supreme Court declared that they are the protectors of the Constitution. They are the guardians of the Constitution also. And then, once again, while interpreting the Constitution, they said that Constitution can be divided into two parts. One part is the basic structure of the Constitution, and remaining part is not a part of the basic structure of the Constitution. And though Parliament has an authority to amend the Constitution, but the Parliament has no authority to amend the basic structure of the Constitution. Amendment in basic structure of Constitution means destroying the Constitution itself. And Supreme Court says, we don't believe that the Constitution makers might have provided a provision in the Constitution. It said that Constitution should be destroyed. So we don't believe in this, and therefore Parliament has no authority to amend the basic structure of the Constitution. And this basic structure also contains the philosophy of the Constitution. The basic structure also contains the secular, liberal, democratic philosophy of the Constitution. Dr. Ambedkar has a deep faith in the Constitution. He said that in his speech of 25th November 1949, he categorically said that if India wants to see that the Constitution is survived, if India wants to see that the democracy survive, then for transforming the society, the people must adopt the constitutional means, no other means. If there is no other remedy, then it is all right. But Constitution has provided the mechanism for transforming the society, and therefore constitutional means must be adapted. And therefore the basic structure says supremacy of the Constitution. Constitution is supreme, and all other institutions created by the Constitution are supplementary to the Constitution. They are not the supreme bodies. Neither the President of India, nor the Parliament of India, nor the Executive, and nor the Judiciary. They are not supreme bodies. Only Constitution is a supreme body. Another thing is the democratic and republic character of the Constitution. Parliament doesn't have a right to change the democratic republic structure of the Constitution. Constitution established democracy in India. Constitution guarantees its perpetuity, its continuity in India, because as a part of the basic structure, Constitution is beyond the authority of the Parliament to amend the Constitution. Then, federal character. Dr. Ambedkar's Constitution declared India as a federation, as a federal state constituted by states and central government. And separate lists are being given in the Constitution. One list is called the central list, another list is called the state list, third list is called the concurrent list. And in the sphere of state list, in the area of state list, states are sovereign. In the central list, the center is sovereign. And therefore, center and state each other must respect their sovereignty and function like a federal state. And then secularism is also a part of the basic structure of the Constitution in India. I say that on an offer. The principle of secularism is undermined by the persons who are holding the constitutional positions and still undermining this principle of secularism. In brief, I try to explain you in this way. In brief, I try to explain you the philosophy of Dr. B. R. Ambedkar, which is enshrined in the Constitution of India. But while giving the Constitution, Dr. Ambedkar had cautioned the people of India and particularly the representatives of Parliament and the legislature. Dr. Ambedkar said that India is basically an undemocratic society. Therefore, cultivating constitutional morality is needed not only among the representatives, but among the masses also. Constitutional morality for Dr. Ambedkar means the highest regard for the constitution, highest regard for the institutions created by the constitution. While expressing the hope of dissent, while differing on various issues, the opposition also should respect the constitution, and through constitutional means, they should express their vote of dissent also. But we fail to cultivate the constitutional morality in the masses, and therefore, every day, day in and day out, the constitution is being undermined, constitution is being disrespected. Another thing, the practice of this present government, since they got elected first in 2014 to the parliament and now in 2019. Dr. Ambedkar said that the form of constitution and the form of administration should be consistent to each other. Otherwise, if they are not consistent to each other, by changing the form of the constitution, changing the form of the administration, constitution can be distorted and can be made dysfunctional. The Modi present Modi government is doing the same thing without amending the constitution. Only by changing the form of administration, the Modi government is distorting the constitution, is damaging the constitution, is destroying the constitution slowly. I will give one or two examples. Repealing of Article 70. This is the example of distorting of the constitution only by changing the form of addition. Bypassing the Rajya Sabha and all the bills where majority, BJP has a majority in the Lok Sabha. The bills are passed in Lok Sabha only and Rajya Sabha is bypassed. These are some of the examples of by changing the form of the constitution can be damaged, constitution can be distorted, constitution can be made dysfunctional. And in the last speech in the Constituent Assembly, Dr. Ambedkar said that political democracy is incomplete. Political democracy should be transformed or must be transformed in social democracy. Unless and until it is transformed in social democracy, political democracy will always be in danger. What is the meaning of social democracy for Dr. Ambedkar? Meaning is very simple. The principles of liberty, equality, and fraternity should be made a way of life. We should follow these principles as a way of thinking. Means one man, one vote, one value. But the social democracy means one man, one value. We fail in transforming political democracy into social democracy also. We failed in cultivating the constitutional morality. We failed to educate our representatives to check or to prohibit the process of distorting the constitution through administrative decisions in the parliament. And we also failed to transform political democracy into the social democracy. And therefore, Dr. Ambedkar said in the on 4th November 1948 in the Constituent Assembly that I feel that it is workable, it is flexible, and it is strong enough to hold the country together in both peace and war time. Indeed, if I may say so, if things go wrong under the new constitution, the reason will not be that we had a bad constitution. What we will have to say that the man is vile. And the man proved to be vile, and therefore constitution is distorted, constitution is destroyed, and democracy is the ruining state. We have started our journey in 1952 by multi-party political democracy. With multi-party political democracy, in 2020, we arrived at the juncture where now, at present in India, there is a one-party dictatorship, only dictatorship of one party. The bad part of it is, this is not a political party at all, because BJP doesn't have a political philosophy of its own. BJP is a member of the family, and RSS family is also using the political philosophy. Therefore, this dictatorship is based on Hindutva philosophy. And if this philosophy starts ruling India, it has started ruling India, and if the present democracy is converted into one party dictatorship, then the OBCs, the scheduled caste, the tribals, and the women will be again enslaved. There will be no future for the minorities, religious minorities. Therefore, task before us is taking Dr. Ambedkar to the masses, taking Dr. Ambedkar's philosophy to the masses, taking constitution to the masses, not only the constitution as given in the constitution of India, but the constitutional philosophy to the masses. The process will be education, agitation, and organization. Here, education means generating awareness about the constitutional philosophy, generating awareness about their own state, generating about their own situation, so that future generations will not be enslaved. We have to take the constitution and mobilize the people against the present rule, against the philosophy, Hindutva philosophy. Dr. Ambedkar's philosophy, constitutional philosophy, is the only alternative before us to counter the Hindutva philosophy. And there is no other way out except take this philosophy to the people and make them aware. I will conclude with the last verse of Dr. Ambedkar. Ours is a battle. We are battling. Ours is a battle. It is not a battle for wealth, neither for political power. It is a battle for restoring human dignity. Restoring human dignity. Because human dignity is in jeopardy. Human dignity is in trouble. And to restore this, which is guaranteed by the constitution, to restore that particular human dignity, we have to go to the people. We have to take the constitution to the people. Here, I will conclude it. And before concluding it, I would like to appeal to you. This is a volume which is called Constituent Assembly debate in Marathi. This is translated by Vandana Sangha and published by Vandana Sangha. This publication is in 10 volumes. We want to donate these volumes to the Viharas and to the study centers, but we are not in a position to donate it. If your group can sponsor at least 25 states, then we will be able to give it to the Viharas and the study centers also. Thanks once again for providing me this opportunity. My friend, Mr. Vaman is just indicating me that we have also launched a lecture series called Dr. B.R. Ambedkar, Honorable Dr. B.R. Ambedkar, a father of Constitution of India. It is in Hindi. The title is the title of the lecture series is Bharat ke Samvidhan ke Nirmata Dr. B.R. Ambedkar. It is being telecast on Maitri India and it has commenced on 25th October 2020 on the eve of Dhamma Chakra Pravartan Day, and it will be a lecture series of 52 lectures. If somebody wants to see or listen this particular lecture series, they can visit Maitri India. That's all. So thank you very much for providing me this opportunity. I will stop here, and if interactions are there, they are requested.
Okay. Thank you, Godeswar sir. It was really, really very enlightening sessions, in the sense there are so many things we were also not aware of. Means even if we are learned and try to read as much as possible, there are some intricacies which you explain. I will not go into the detail of everything, considering the time we lost due to technical issues. So I will straight away go to this Q&A session. So there is one questions on the YouTube channel we received, and the participant is asking a question. So if Constitution is able to abolish the untouchability, why there is no provision to abolish the caste system? That is what the questions coming in the YouTube.
There is no provision for abolition of the caste system in our constitution, no doubt about that. But abolition of untouchability will ultimately lead to abolition of caste system that was visualized when framing the particular constitution. We must realize that Dr. Ambedkar was a single person in the Constituent Assembly. Number of things he wanted to incorporate in the constitution, but he could not incorporate in the constitution because majority of the members were belonging to the Congress party, and there were Hindutva forces in the Congress itself also. So in this particular critical situation, he had to draft this particular constitution, and that is the great provision that it is incorporated abolition of untouchability. And it is expected. This I talk about social democracy. It is up to us now to take the constitution in that way and transform political democracy into social democracy, and that will lead to the abolition of the caste system.
Thank you, sir. There is one more question on the YouTube. Scenarios which happened recently were and is against the constitution. How constitutional values will be going to survive in coming future?
Now, see, I said that even the Supreme Court is under Supreme Court who declare itself that they are the protectors and guardians of the Constitution of India. But still now at present, the recent analysis of some judgments of the Supreme Court reveal that the Supreme Court is also under the influence of the government now, and therefore the judgment are biased one, particularly the judgment about the Ram Mandir and other judgment about this Pranab Goswami judgment and other things. But there is only one alternative, and the alternative is mobilizing the people against this Hindutva forces. There is no other alternative. And we have to fight a battle. It is a battle of ideologies. It is a battle of philosophies. Dr. Ambedkar's philosophy against Hindutva philosophy. They are determined to convert India into a Hindu Rashtra. And it is our task now. We have identified the task that without people's mobilization, because people are supreme, if people can take lead, then there is a possibility that we will be able to save the constitution. There is no other alternative at all.
Okay. So I think Mahesh Vasnik has a question. Mahesh, do you want to unmute yourself and ask, or do you want me to ask on your behalf? The question is basically on, can you please highlight this current form bill issues?
Pardon?
Can you please highlight the current farm bill issues? The farmers issue is going on, so farmers agitation and all this. So Mahesh Vasnik wants to know, can you please highlight that particular issue?
This issue has become a bone of contention for the ruling party now. The campaign is going on. Yesterday this farmers has brought in their own newsletter called Trolley Times to just neutralize the propaganda of the government. This issue is basically that farmers want a guarantee that minimum support price will be guaranteed by the state. Number one, there will, please. Minimum support price will be guaranteed by enacting a law. Number two, the marketing committees will remain as it is. Then third thing is the private enterprises will not be allowed to take their lands by mortgage or by anything else. And the major criticism is nobody demanded for these particular laws. But government enacted that, number one, without consulting the farmers whose interests are at stake. And they say that in the democracy, government has to listen to us. The problem issue is issue of minimum support price. The issue is protecting their lands from the encroachment of the multinationals. And these are the issues more important for the farmers, and therefore they are agitating. Now, government wants to return the acts, and the agitators say that they will see that the acts are abolished.
Okay, thanks, sir. So there is one more question from Jayashri Kambe. And she's asking, how do you get the larger population, not just Viharas and our community, to have access to the ideas of the constitution? And is it possible to do simple, almost children-like books to distill these ideas for wide circulation?
Circulation is one thing. But there is a need to have a direct contact with the people. We have limited ourselves to the American people only. But we had conducted an experiment in 2015. That experiment was on the eve of 125th birth anniversary of Dr. Ambedkar, Jayanti of Dr. Ambedkar. And in that particular year, we organized 125 lectures in remote villages, simply to take the constitution to the people. And the response was good. Response in the sense, because the basic condition was the lectures will not be organized in Viharas. Lectures will be organized in the public places. All the village population will be invited. And the sarpanch of that particular village will be the chairperson of that particular meeting. And in this way, we approach to the people. We could convince the people that constitution is for everybody. Constitution is not for a particular community. It is drafted for Indians. You are Indian. I am Indian. And I am here to address you as an Indian. This is our relationship of brotherhood. And therefore, please, please see that constitution is for all the Indian people. And if in this way we will, if we could be able to mobilize the people, then there is a possibility that people will accept this particular constitution as our constitution. We and they, this relation should be abolished, and we together will, we have to establish this type of relationship. If you want to take the constitution, constitution must be there. With religion, we can go with them. Because everybody at present in 70 years, we could not propagate our religion on a much larger scale. Therefore, constitution can be an appealing document, can be appealing principle to all of us. And with this constitution, if you go to the people, if you go to the reached and unreached both, then we can unite the people, we can organize the people, we can educate the people. And only because in the democracy, in the constitutional process, this is the only remedy, that going to the people. As I said, Supreme Court is not there, our representatives are not talking in the parliament, because we fail to elect the proper representatives. We fail to elect the proper representatives also.
Okay. Thank you, sir. So I think, does anyone have any questions? So please raise your hand. I have one question, sir. So you said that Article 25 is for the freedom of religion. And we know the Gujarat government and recently the UP government has made it very difficult for conversion. So how does this particular, their laws or whatever the things they have established in Gujarat as well as the UP is not in violation of the Article 25, the freedom of religion?
The recent developments are, there are laws enacted by the state governments which are ruled by the BJP. They are against the conversion, but they do not say that they are against the conversion. They say that the laws, I will come to this particular law enactment. The laws say that if somebody wants to convert to another religion, then the collector's permission is necessary. So there are the laws. They are challenged in the Supreme Court. But now come to this laws against this particular law here, and conversion for marriage purposes. They are prohibited by the law of UP government, by the law of Madhya Pradesh, by the law of Karnataka government, and Haryana government is also enacting this particular law. This law is being challenged in the Allahabad High Court now. This law is being challenged, and government, a notice is being issued to the government to clarify this particular issue, because the recent Allahabad High Court judgment in these particular cases categorically say that freedom of religion is there, and the adults have a choice to whom to get married, to whom they can live, and therefore this law is against their freedom of religion, the law is against their freedom of choice also, and this is being challenged in the Allahabad High Court. If Allahabad High Court gives a proper judgment, then the matter will be over, but matter will not be over. Matter will again go to the Supreme Court. And finally, Supreme Court has to interpret this particular law, whether it is against the Article 25 or it is not against the Article 25. But laws are being challenged in the course of law.
Okay. Thank you, sir. That was the last questions, and we are also at the end of the session. So before closing, do you have any concluding remarks?
No, just I would like to express my thanks, sincere thanks to all of you. The concluding remarks will be like this, that philosophical awareness generation is more important than anything else. Glorifying Dr. Ambedkar, this strategy is being adopted by the RSS since 2014. The Rashtriya Swayamsevaka celebrates on a large scale the jayantis of Dr. B.R. Ambedkar. BJP has started building monuments in the memory of Dr. B.R. Ambedkar. This we call glorifying the individual and murdering the thoughts of that particular individual. And therefore, we have to be cautious about all these things. And national and international level, we have to get support in this particular mission to take the constitution and Dr. Ambedkar's philosophy to the masses. Thanks once again for inviting me to deliver this particular talk to the international audience. And I hope it will be of some meaning to you. Thank you very much.
Okay. Thank you, Gudisar sir. And about the books, you are asking us to see whether we can do some funding of that to make it available in Viharas or some other places. We will see what we can do from our side or personally how we can contribute to that. We will definitely look into this one. So thank you again, Gudisar sir, for giving your valuable time to Boston Study Group for our Ambedkar lecture series. And thank you, Vaman Somkurji, for providing the technical support and setting up Zoom for Gudisar sir. And most important, Sahadev Chavanji, who is coordinating with you and the Boston Study Group to get this particular session. And to everybody who is online, on YouTube, Facebook, as well as on Zoom, thank you very much for participating. Jai Bhim, and have a wonderful rest of the day.
Thank you. Thank you.